Hello and welcome to episode 32 of the Alfa Romeo Driver Podcast, brought to you by the Alfa Romeo Owners Club. And this afternoon, I'm delighted to have with me best-selling crime fiction author and former Owners Club GT registrar, James Oswald. Good afternoon, James.
Good afternoon.
We've been trying to set this up for a while. I know you've been really, really busy on the farm. We'll talk a little bit about that later on. But typically when we do these things, we kind of start off with why we're talking to you in the first place. So how did you get involved in Alfas originally?
It goes a long, long way back. My first ever car after I passed my driving test in 1985 was an Alfetta GTV. And it sounds like quite a posh car for your first car, but actually it was 10 years old when I bought it. It cost me £750. And then I started trying to find some insurance for it, and it cost more to insure than it did to buy, even in 1985. I had that when I went up to university. I had that for about 4 years, that car, and then it dissolved on me in the way of these things. But I caught the Alfa bug then, and I'd always fancied a spider. I remember when I was very young, going out to France. My uncle lived and worked in France and went to stay with him. And he took us to this chateau. Parked outside the chateau was what I later discovered was a Duetto spider. I didn't know what it was at the time. Just this had this wonderful Alfa Romeo script on the back of that round tail boot. And I just thought it was the coolest thing. Once I got into Alfa Romeos, I suddenly realized, oh, this is this car that I remembered from when I was about sort of 6 or 7 or something. So I tried to find one of those that I could afford around about the time when I graduated. And I got a mad idea that I'd buy a crashed one and restore it. And I bought that. I bought a Spider in 1991, I think it was. I've still got it to this day. And I did restore it. It took me a very long time. In the interim, I've had a 33, which was a great little car. I loved that when I was living just outside Edinburgh and just south of Edinburgh, and I discovered McLennan's garage in Lonehead was very useful for keeping that on the road. But it too finally dissolved, as a lot of Alphas of that era did.
Yeah.
And then I've had some non-Alfa Romeo cars down the year, but we'll say very little about them. I was working it out before coming on. I've had 4 GTs. I've had 2 diesels and 2 V6s. And I did run the GT register for a while. And I've now got a GTA sport wagon, which I've had for about 10 years. It was that first car just by accident. And that's what got me into Alfas.
And how did you get involved with the club? You said you were the GT registrar. How did that come about?
Well, it started off with the Spider, the Duetto, and I bought that, and it was a basket case. It had been in an accident which had taken the front of it off, so it had no.
So it was exactly what you were looking for.
Yeah, it was exactly what I was looking for. And I thought it was red. Turned out when I started stripping it back that it was originally white, and it had a hard life up to then. I bought that, and then I sort of needed to find parts and people who knew how to work on them and things like that. And I got used to get the classic car magazines and everything. And I think there was probably an ad for the Alfa Romeo Owners Club, so I just joined. That was back when the magazine was a little sort of A5 thing or whatever that came through. And I mainly joined so that I could find out where all the supplies, difficult to find spare parts were. I got a little bit involved with the Scottish section, but not very much. Found out about that. I think there was an Alfa garage in Edinburgh that closed down, and I remember going to they had a parts sale organised there, which I found out through the club, which was really useful because I needed a new front bumper, one of the front bumpers for the Duetto, which were really difficult to find and really expensive. And they just happened to have one on the shelf in, I think it was Fraser's Garage, it was called or something, in Edinburgh. And they had one on the shelf and it cost me 80 quid. And I thought, that's a bargain. So that was kind of why I joined. I didn't really do much in the club because the Spider took decades to get back on the road because I either had time to work on it or money, but never both. And so it sat in a shed on the farm for a long time. But I did come into some money at one point and needed a daily driver, and I almost bought a 156 sport wagon. I always liked the sport wagon, but we were in living in Wales at the time, and went to Mangaletsi's and had a test drove a sport wagon, but also saw that the new then GT had only just come out, and it was a bit more than I could really afford, but did a little bit of sort of finance man maths, as they say, and got the GT, and that kind of rekindled my first GT. It was 2005, and I got in touch with the club and said, you know, is anyone, who's the GT register? Who's running the GT register? So we haven't got one. Do you want to run it? I foolishly said yes. I ended up doing that for about 5 or 6 years, I think, and working my way through all the various different GT models at the time.
So did you start with the diesel or did you start with the Busso?
No, I started with the diesel because I was living in Wales at the time. My partner worked on a research farm. She was the a senior research scientist on a research farm near Aberystwyth. But the farm is in North East Fife, so it's about 400 miles between the two, which we travelled quite a lot. We do that sort of maybe once every couple of months, if not more often than that. I didn't really fancy 23, 24 miles to the gallon doing that journey. Whereas the diesel, you could do it all on, you know, there and halfway back again on the tank. So
yeah. So when did the Busso come along then?
I always fancied one. I'd had my original GT, the diesel, for about, I guess, 3 years, and the mileage, we weren't doing quite as much mileage, and I thought, maybe I could justify having a V6. I was getting much more into the club and things like that as well, and I guess that would have been about, I suppose, 2008. I got the first one, and I got it in Bristol. A little garage in Bristol. It wasn't a main dealer or anything. I was just looking around for something that would fit my budget. And it was great. It was a lovely car. I really enjoyed it. But then our mileage started to go back up again because, rather tragically, my parents died in a car accident, which is how I ended up coming back to Fife to take on the family farm. So I was suddenly going back up and down and up and down. So I thought I couldn't really justify the V6 and traded it in for another diesel, a newer diesel. And that was, so I guess that would have been around about 2008, 2009. So the first V6 I didn't have for very long, but I missed it. Once I got the diesel, I really missed it. And the second one, I always fancied, I'm trying to remember that it's a very purpley metallic red. Is it Brunello red? I think it is, which is quite rare for the GT. And I really fancied one of those. And I found one on eBay. And you should never buy things on cars on eBay. It's a really bad idea. I didn't pay very much money for it, but I don't feel I lost out too much. But the second one, it was a lovely, lovely colour. And I swapped over the interior because the interior for the diesel one was a lovely, lovely pale natural leather, really light. Because the one thing about the GT is it's very dark because it's got very little glass.
Yeah.
And I much prefer a light interior. So I actually swapped over the interiors between the two, sold the diesel with a dark black leather interior, and I had my Maranello red, Brunello red GT V6 for a couple of years. But by that time, I'd moved up to the farm. I was running the farm, writing books, and not driving anywhere because both of my jobs are at home. Annual mileage went from about 18,000 down to about 3,000. Well, the GT was off the road for a year. I just put it on Sorn because I didn't need a car at all. And I had the GTA as well at that point, a sport wagon, which was also sitting in a barn doing nothing. So in the end, I thought, well, I'll sell it. I can't remember whether it was through the Facebook. I think it might have been through Facebook, the Alfa Romeo Owners Club Facebook pages. And I got in touch with Dan Cunningham, who runs Autoluso Penrith, and he was quite interested in it. And he did actually buy it off me, but actually when he got it back to his workshop, he discovered that it was completely rusted through in the floor pan. So he stripped it down for parts, and that V6 is, I don't know where it's ended up. But that is a problem with the GTs, particularly the earlier ones. They had a tendency for their floor pans to rust through, and you don't notice until, you know, something falls off and suddenly it's an MOT failure or whatever.
So I don't want to spoil too much about the GTA Sportwagon because we're in the privileged position of having an article in the next issue, which will comes out in a couple of weeks' time, talking about the restoration for that. So you've still got the Duetto, you've got the GTA Sportwagon, but you've hinted at it already. You don't get to drive them very much, do you?
I don't do any driving at all. The Duetto, for a couple of years, I did about 15 miles a year, which was to the MOT station and back. And partly because I just don't have the time. I run the farm and I write two novels a year. I have been doing that for the last 9 years. And it just doesn't really leave much time for anything else. But also, as I said before, I don't really have anywhere to drive. And the last time I took the Duetto for a decent spin, a couple of years ago, midlife crisis and everything, and I started hankering after another Alfetta. And there was one for sale not very far from here, about, I guess it must be about 25 miles or so, the other side of Kinross. And I went to have a look at it, but rather than driving over in the farm pickup or whatever, I thought, it's a nice day, I'll dig out the Duetto. Drove over there, had a lovely afternoon driving the GTV around, and really enjoyed it, very nearly bought it. But then I got back home and I'd really enjoyed driving the Duetto because I'd such a long time since I'd gone anywhere further than the nearest town. So I thought, actually, I don't need the Alfetta. I've got a perfectly good Alfa Romeo. I just need to drive it. But yes, I actually want to. That's got a really bad paint job. When it was finally restored, they did an absolutely atrocious paint job on it. So I'm kind of toying with the idea of stripping it back down again and getting the paint job done properly. But my big problem, as you'll know from having read the article that I've written, is that probably means that the car will be off the road for a year or two, and at which point I'll be doing no driving at all. And who knows when I'll ever get back into it. I used to love driving. I used to drive hundreds of miles. Any excuse, drop of a hat to go for a long drive. But I've just kind of fallen out of the habit.
Our traditional closing question on these podcasts is, what would you like to buy next? But it sounds as though there wouldn't be a lot of point apart from looking at it.
Well, there's so many cars I'd love. I'd love a Giulia Quadrifoglio. I gave my Detective Inspector McLean, I gave him one of those. He used to drive around in a Bertone 105, he'd inherited from his father. And that was kind of, I thought if I put Alfa Romeos in the books, maybe Alfa Romeo would sponsor me. But they didn't, sadly. Not even the Italian publisher. I said to the Italian publisher, because it's the first three have been translated into Italian, and I said, you could pay me in a classic Alfa Romeo instead of actual, euros. But they didn't know. They just paid me in euros. Very boring.
So let's go back. You said you've been doing that for 9 years. Let's go back 9 or 10 years. How did you get into becoming an author?
Well, it's always been something I wanted to do. Farming is just this kind of a fallback position. And I've always been writing. My first story that I ever had published and got paid money for was a comic script that I wrote for 2000 AD comic, which was published in 1993. And I thought, great, I'm going to be a comics writer. This is my career. But that didn't really happen. I sent them lots and lots more stories, but they never bought anything. So I then had to actually do a proper job to earn a living. But I was always writing. And before moving down to Wales, I lived in Edinburgh for a while. And before that, I lived in Aberdeen. In Aberdeen, I was great friends with a chap called Stuart McBride, who's another crime fiction author. And I was writing fantasy and comics and things, and he was doing similar. But then he switched to writing crime fiction and got published and introduced me to a lot of crime fiction people. And he said, you should try writing crime fiction. So that's kind of what I did. I took a character that I'd written a comic script about, this chap called Tony McLean, who was a policeman who could sort of possibly see the ghosts and demons and things that were behind all the evil things going on. And I thought, well, I'll modernize and bring him into the modern world and write a crime story. And so because he'd originally been set in Edinburgh, the stories were set in Edinburgh. And that was back in, I think I wrote the first one of those in about 2005 and sent it out to publishers. And they all came back and said, oh, it's really good. We really like this story, but there's no market for crime where you get to the end of the book and it turns out it was a demon or a ghost or whatever. There's, you know, crime and supernatural don't mix. So I couldn't get a publisher for that. And I put it in for a couple of prestigious competitions in the crime fiction world, and I got shortlisted for the first two books in the series, but didn't win. And again, publishers were calling them in and saying, "Can we, you know, we love the writing, but, you know, can you take the ghosts out or whatever?" And I said, "Well, no, that's the whole point of the books. You can't really take them out." And then eventually, I this was around about the same time that my parents died, and I was taking over the farm, and I didn't have enough time to concentrate too much on the writing. So I decided, well, the first two books in the series, which I'd written and which had obviously been well received by publishers, they just didn't know how to sell them, I would self-publish. This was around about the time that the Kindle, Amazon's Kindle, was really taking off. So I put them out, and I hit upon this brilliant idea with the first book, Natural Causes, to give it away for free for a while. And people could download it for free, read it, and if they liked it, they could buy the second one. And I thought I might sell a couple of thousand copies over the course of a year. But it absolutely took off. It was the spring of 2012, and it went from nothing to selling 2,000 copies a day, or being downloaded 2,000 copies a day. And then the second book, I brought the second book out quite quickly, and that was selling 1,000 copies a day. I was getting paid for that. It was like, wow, this is brilliant. I went that year to, because I had, as I had been doing every year, to the big crime fiction festival, literary festival, which is in Harrogate every year in July. And everyone was coming up saying, "This is brilliant, James. How have you done this? What have you done?" I had no idea. I just put these things up there and people liked them. But all the publishers were suddenly interested as well. And that year I managed to get, I got an agent, and I got a really good publishing deal with Penguin. And it took off from there. And I haven't really sat down. Well, I haven't really stood up since, because I've been sat down at my desk writing. And the book that I'm working on at the moment will be my 20th published novel, which will come out in February of next year. So about 9 years after the first one, which gives you some indication as to why I don't have time to drive much.
Indeed. So have you created a new genre of supernatural crime fiction, or is it still pretty much just you?
No, I don't think I've created it. I think there were some people doing stuff. And if you go back to the origins of crime fiction, you have people like Wilkie Collins and the Moonstone and Arthur Conan Doyle, that mysticism is all built into it anyway. And it's only a fairly recent thing where everything's got to be completely rational, and you get the concept of the police procedural and the author who goes out on patrol with the policeman to see how it's done properly, so he gets it right in his books and everything. And they kind of forgot that stories are, you know, to start with, they're fiction and anything goes. But there are some other great authors who've, you know, long before I was doing it, were doing that kind of thing. John Connolly, for instance, has been a great Irish author with his Charlie Parker books. The first one was a kind of spooky but quite straight novel, and they've just got more and more supernatural with each one. And he's a brilliant writer doing that sort of thing. Sarah Pinborough is another one. I mean, her thriller Behind Her Eyes was recently done on the television, a huge success on Netflix, which is, you know, it's on the face of it, it's a contemporary thriller, but it's also got a supernatural core running right through the middle of it. So there's lots of other authors doing it. But what I kind of came up against was publishing. The publishing industry is very small C conservative sometimes, and they didn't know how to sell it. They didn't want to put anything. And if you look at my books now, if you pick them up in the shop and look at the blurb on the back, it doesn't mention ghosts and demons and ghouls and things. It might say dark forces of evil or something, but it won't say anything more than that. Because if they put that in, then it gets put in the horror section or the fantasy section, and you only sell about 10% as many as you would as if it was in the crime section. So they come hard down on the police procedural side of things and kind of gloss over the fact that I like to twist all these supernatural themes and elements into the books.
And how hard is it to maintain the balance on that? Because there's a very strong, you know, very convincing police procedural element to the books, and then the supernatural bit is kind of always there in the background and twisted in and pops up at the right times. Yeah.
Well, I kind of approach the books in my mind. I know that such and such a character is not entirely human, or such and such has happened by non-human influences. But Tony McLean, my character, doesn't believe in all that stuff. So there's always a search for a rational explanation. And I like that's kind of how I treat it. So I have all of the police procedural stuff, going through the motion of the investigation and finding the clues and tracking down the people who've done the stuff. But I've always just got in the background, and I try not to be absolutely come straight out and say such and such a character is the devil incarnate wandering around the world and Edinburgh and making life difficult for people. I just drop hints rather than come out and say it. So you can read these books if you don't want to, accept that the Middle Eastern jinn wandering around the city devouring children or whatever. There is another way of reading it so that it's not quite so obvious. And that's what I like, to be a bit ambiguous about it. It doesn't always work. Sometimes you just have to say, sod it. There's no explanation for what happened other than it was a ghost. He woke up and it was all a dream. Well, that's always the problem, though. That's because if you write a really, really complicated whodunit and everyone's trying to guess whodunit, and it turns out at the end that it was a ghost, then you're letting your readers down. And I really don't want to do that. So I don't tend to write whodunit. So usually you know who's done it from the first page. It's more a how done it or a why done it, and how do they find out, and what goes horribly wrong whilst they're doing it. So it's more that kind of story rather than, which is how I can weave the supernatural stuff in, I think.
So obviously, given our listeners, I've got to ask the really important questions about the novels. So when did the 105 enter the scene in terms of your writing process? So did the comic strip version of Tony McLean drive an alpha, or?
No, it was very much the when I was writing the first book, and he needed a car, and he borrowed his mate's car for a while, but then. And there was an early scene where, which got deleted from natural causes, where he borrowed his friend's car and went down to this other house, which he didn't even know existed, which his parents had owned and he'd thought had been sold or whatever, but turned out it was still his. And the car was there in a garage, and he had to get it just sort of refettled and restored before he could use it. I changed that slightly and just decided that it was his grandmother who'd restored it, but kept it under wraps, and he just needed a car. He'd not needed a car before, but he suddenly needed one, and it was there and handy. And I was slightly worried about sort of going down the Inspector Morse line and having him being this idiosyncratic detective driving around in a sort of 40-50 year old car, but it seemed to go down quite well with the readers, so I kept it for a while.
And without giving away too many spoilers, because obviously we'd like everybody to go and buy all 20 of the books, the 105 meets an unfortunate end, doesn't it? What was the decision
Twice,
behind that?
Actually, at the end of book three, a body falls from about 3-4 stories up onto its roof. Doesn't do it much good, but he gets it restored. And then I can't remember which book it is, but it has a horrible crash. He has a horrible crash in really, really bad snowy weather, like it's blizzard weather in the city and ice on the roads. But we drop hints as to whether he's lost control or whether it's actually been attacked by some weird creature of myth, written in bones. That's the one, which I love that book because it starts with them finding a body in the top of a tree in the middle of the city. And just kind of a really mad idea that came to me whilst I was trying to think of something else. So at the end of that book, it's in a sorry state. It's the back of a pickup truck with a flatbed truck with a tarpaulin over it, and I don't know what's happened to it. I don't know whether he's going to get it restored, but in the interim, he gets himself a Giulia Quadrifoglio, because I was still ever hopeful that Alfa Romeo UK might sponsor me, and he drove that for a couple of books, and then it got nicked. And parked sideways in a shop and written off. So at the moment, he's tooling around in his girlfriend's Renault Zoe electric car, which is a bit of a come down, but easier to park.
Yes. Any plans for an Alfa replacement?
Well, the problem is there's not much choice these days, is there? He gets a Giulia or a Stelvio. He doesn't strike me as an SUV type. I might get the 105 restored and get that back. But at the moment, he's pottering around town in this little Renault. But as soon as he has to go any great distance in it, he's going to realise it's not so good.
I was devastated when you told me about the Giulia, because obviously, everybody said when the lockdown started, everybody who'd never written a book said, we're going to take this opportunity of being stuck at home and write a novel. And I actually ended up falling so far behind reading novels that I'm a couple of books behind in the series. But on the police procedural part, I've obviously, like most readers, I've not worked for Police Scotland. So I don't know how authentic the policing side of it is. But how much research do you have to do to make it authentic enough for people not to poke holes in it?
A lot less than you would expect is the simple answer. The worst thing is the first two books I wrote, A, I was living in Wales whilst I wrote them, and B, it was Lothian and Borders Police then. Before then, Scotland was split up into regions much the same way as England is for the police force. But then they had this brilliant idea to amalgamate the whole lot into this thing called Police Scotland. So I had to relearn the way everything works. At the same time, I have to admit, as most of the police officers were relearning how everything works, because for the first year or 18 months, none of them had a clue. But I never really wanted to write police procedurals. I didn't really like that idea of, writing something really, really close to and using all the jargon and everything. I know some writers do it really, really well, but I didn't want to have to do that level of research. I'm not very good at going and asking people for help. So the idea of picking up the phone and seeing if I could find a police officer who would talk me through procedure kind of left me a bit cold. So I tend to approach the book where if I find myself, whilst I'm writing a scene, obsessing about what would be the correct way, the right way the police would approach something, I'll tend to go back and rewrite the scene so that I don't need to know that. So they are technically police procedurals, but there's not an awful lot of procedure in them. And a lot of it is just, it skirts around the actual detail, but I just always think, is it plausible? Are they doing something stupid? Or is this more or less what you see when you see news reports rather than watching The Bill or whatever? I mean, I get a lot of information from watching The Bill reading the books of Stuart McBride and Ian Rankin and people like that. And I do have a few police contacts who I can run stuff by if I need to. But I tend not to. I tend to try and avoid doing that because I think you run the risk of bogging the story down if you go off on a great tangent explaining the exact procedure for finding a lost child or whatever. It doesn't move the story on, it stops it. And the other thing that I did an event at Bloody Scotland, the big Scottish crime fiction festival, a couple of years back with Dame Professor Sue Black, or is she Professor Dame Sue Black? I don't know. So the forensic...
The order's important.
The order is important. I always get it wrong. She's a really fascinating person, and she's a forensic scientist, and has developed all sorts of techniques for identifying how people have been murdered or whatever. And she gets quite often asked to be an expert witness at trial. And she finds the biggest problem is that she can stand up there and she can explain to the jury and the judge and whatever what something is. And half of the time, the jury don't believe her because they've seen CSI and it's different on CSI. And I worry about that. If I'm pretending that what I write is absolutely correct procedure, then people might buy into that and think that the things that happen in my book happen in real life. And I kind of want to shy away from that a bit and get rid of the myth of the writer researching everything down to the nth degree. Because at the end of the day, there's ghosts and ghouls and demons running around in my stories. Yeah.
It's difficult to get the procedural bits of that right. Although I guess there is established mythology that you kind of need to, if not follow, that at least recognize that this stuff, you haven't originated some of this stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I probably do more research into that side of things than I do into the police side of things. The last one that came out the beginning of this year, What Will Burn, that's got witches in it. I did a lot of reading up about the persecution of witches in Scotland in the 16th and 17th centuries, and which is fascinating stuff. Not much of it made it into the books, but I did read an awful lot about it. And so yes, there is an accepted mythology behind things like, you know, jinns, genies, and you know, it's not all just rubbing a brass lamp and three wishes. There's all sorts of stuff if you dig a bit deeper into the stories behind them. And that it all feeds into the stories. It makes them much more interesting. Much more interesting than dry procedure anyway.
Do you have in mind a kind of longer term arc? Because, I mean, he's getting older, he's getting more senior. You know, at some point in the real world, he'd retire. I suppose he could end up in the basement doing cold cases.
In the basement, yeah. Well, that's what happened with Inspector Rebus, I think, because he had to retire, and then Ian Rankin brought him back, working on old cases. Tony McLean's got a few years left in him yet. It's probably no great secret to tell you that he gets demoted. He never wanted to be chief inspector, so he gets demoted at the beginning of What Will Burn. So he's back where he wants to be, just an inspector, so he can actually go out and do. That's another one of these problems with these stories, though, because you get, I think Peter James is he chief superintendent Roy Grace now or something? It's really, really quite senior. Would never go anywhere near a crime scene, but because it's fiction and because you want your character to be out there asking the difficult questions and chasing down the crooks, you do that anyway. Whereas, you know, anything above inspector, and to a certain extent inspectors themselves, are management jobs. They're not doing that. They're coordinating the sergeants and the constables to go and do the actual groundwork and running the investigation from a desk. But that doesn't make a very interesting book. No.
And Grace, of course, is another Alpha driver. I think it was a 147 in the books and a sport wagon in the 156, 159.
So Peter James himself, I don't know if he still does it, but he used to do a bit of motor racing, classic motor racing, but he raced BMWs.
Right.
I told him he should have got himself a 105, but yeah, he never did.
So that's Inspector McLean, which is the big series. There's been another couple of series. Where's Constance Fairchild now?
Well, Constance Fairchild was kind of a spin-off from McLean, and I moved publishers from Penguin to Headline, an imprint at Headline, and they wanted a new character as well as more McLean books. So I came up with Con Fairchild. I'm just doing the edits on her third book now, so that'll be out later this year. She drives an old Volvo, so one of those five-cylinder Porsche-engined. I think Porsche did the design for that engine, the T5s, which my other half drives an old Volvo now, so that's kind of...
I'll be careful what I was going to say. I was going to say it suits her character, but...
Yeah. I remember when the Volvo, they did the BTCC with those Volvos, and they did really well up against 155s at Knock Hill, just up the road from here. It was amazing, going rallying, going racing in a Volvo estate. Who'd have thought it? She's working for the NCA, which is kind of the UK, the UK equivalent of the FBI, I guess, National Crime Agency. So she gets to go a bit further afield and look into other things. The book that she's in at the moment, that I'm writing, editing at the moment, she's spending mostly in Wales. I'm revisiting my old Welsh haunts. And my other series is completely different. It's fantasy. It's dragons and magic, Game of Thrones style thing, which I wrote most of when I was in Wales. And it's all inspired by the Welsh language and mythology, and features as its main character a dragon called Sir Benfro, which Sir Benfro is the Welsh for Pembrokeshire. And I always remember when we were doing evening classes, learning to speak Welsh, and we did the Welsh counties. And my partner, she pointed at Sir Benfro and said, "That's got to be the name of the dragon." And that was kind of the start of that. So Whereas most people might have thought that was a funny joke, I went away and wrote about 600,000 words of a fantasy series on it.
Brilliant. Thanks for that fascinating insight into the process behind the novels. But before you go, I'd just like to touch briefly on your next published work, your article for the next issue of Alfa Romeo Driver. How did you become custodian of the GTA Sportwagon?
It was quite an accidental purchase as well. I put in the, I think it was in the GT register column, I put that I was looking for a V6 and I wanted, my ideal car was a Alfa Red with the tan or the very pale leather interior. And I got a phone call or a letter, an email from this guy over just outside Peterborough saying that he'd got a red V6. But it turned out it was the GTA Sportwagon rather than the GT. And it didn't really have tan. It had the black with the tan leather inset in the seats. But I went and had a look at it anyway, because why not? And bought it. And it's a great, it's a lovely car. But like all my cars, I don't get to drive it very much. It's sat in a car coon in one of the farm sheds at the moment. It needs its cam belt service and an MOT, and then I can put it back on the road. But I need to get this novel finished first, and then maybe the one after that, and the one after that.
And there are lots of 156 GTA parts that are getting pretty hard to find, aren't there? I know you had some problems
It's getting to that little bit where people are remanufacturing now. So there's a few things which you can't get for love or money. But there's quite a few, particularly for the V6. There's quite a lot of, you can get all the air hoses and things like that. I need to replace. There's a metal pipe that goes the coolant pipe underneath the front of the radiator. That's rusted through, so it's dropping coolant all over the floor. I've got a stainless steel replacement for that. I just haven't fitted it yet. There's quite a community for the Busso engine cars out there. So I think we'll be keeping it on the road for a little while.
I completely understand the process of accidentally buying a Busso-powered GTA. I went to buy a 2.4 diesel Sportwagon and came home having put down a deposit on a 147 GTA. And there was one of those involved in your eventual GTA purchase as well, wasn't there?
I took my GT to Jamie Porter to be serviced one time because my sister lived over that side of the country. So it kind of fitted in with a trip to go and see her, drop that in. And he gave me an old 164 with no clutch. As a courtesy car. It was a nightmare to drive around for a day whilst it was being serviced. But when I went and picked it up, he took me for a little drive in his 147 GTA that he had at the time. And that kind of, because I'd really wanted to get a V6. That's probably what made me then go and actually start looking for a V6 GT after that, having driven that up and down the Royston bypass at stupid miles an hour.
Jamie's got a lot to answer for. Most of it good. Thanks for taking the time this afternoon, James. It's been fascinating talking to you, and good luck with the latest novel and with the carving. That's all we have time for this week, but we'll be back in 2 weeks' time on the 6th of June with, amongst other things, a preview of the forthcoming National Alfa Day at Bicester Heritage. Episode 33 will be available at 1:30 p.m. from iTunes, YouTube, Podbean, the club website, and anywhere good podcasts can be found. Until then, stay safe.